Okay, the final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 1310 in the name of Foysol Choudhury on linking food and climate change at COP26. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I would ask members who wish to participate to press their request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Mr Choudhury to open the debate for around 7 minutes. Mr Choudhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The eyes of the world are on us here in Scotland, as the 26th United Nations Climate Change Conference, COP26, took place in Glasgow recently. Parliamentarians, world leaders, campaigners and civil society activists were all gathered together with a commitment to tackle climate change. And it was a privilege to be able to attend some of the events associated with COP26. There is no doubt everyone has a part to play in response to the climate emergency. And in this debate today, I hope to be able to highlight some of the commitments in the Glasgow Food and Climate Declaration. This declaration brings together all types and size of local authorities, from small and medium-sized towns to megacities, districts and regions, territories, federal states and provinces, to speak with one voice in renewing their commitments to develop sustainable food policies, promoting mechanism for joined-up action and calling on national governments to put food and farming at the heart of global response to the climate emergency. The declaration was developed by Nourish Scotland in partnership with IPES Food, the Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations FAO, the Global Network of Local Government for Sustainability, the Under 2 Coalition C40, the Milan Urban Food Policy Pact, and many others, and was presented in Glasgow City Chambers during COP26. I commend the City of Edinburgh Council and West Lothian Council as two of the Lothian region local authorities which have signed up to the declaration. On behalf of West Lothian Council, as one of the most recent signatories, Councillor Kirsten Sullivan emphasized with me how the declaration builds on strong partnership work with the West Lothian Food Network, which is committed to removing the barrier to accessing food, as well as recently agreed food growing strategy in the West Lothian, which looks at how food is grown in the local communities. Integrated food policies and strategies will be key tools in the fight against climate change. And I know that other members will be able to give the counts from their own regions of the steps being taken in this regard. The Scottish Government is also to be commended for becoming the lead signatory of the Glasgow Food and Climate Declaration. The Scottish Government and growing number of Scottish local authorities are amongst around 100 current signatories to the declaration. Alongside regions such as Coimbra in Portugal, Catalonia in Spain, and Cross River States in Nigeria, cities such as Sao Paulo, London, Washington, Paris, Vienna, Milan, Quito, Vancouver, and most recently, the government of Honduras. I'm pleased to be able to bring this declaration and all that it stands for to this chamber. Looking at the decisions taken at COP26, whilst important progress was made in many areas, we should note that food systems were not on the presidency agenda, despite accounting for around 30% of global emission. The COP26 agreement did include some commitments on farming. 45 countries pledged urgent action on making farming more sustainable, as well as the commitments on methane. Signatories promised to invest in green agriculture practice in protecting nature. The UK government stated that it is aiming to, for 75% of farmers to engage in low carbon practice by 2030, while Germany promised to lower emission from the land used by 25 million tons by the same year. I would be it would be very helpful if the ministers today could indicate how the Scottish Government will support Scottish farming in achieving the goals set out by the UK Government. There are many examples around Scotland of the efforts being made to contribute to tackle the climate change. And I would like to take this opportunity to congratulate one of the award winners at the recent RSPB Nature of Scotland Awards, which was brought to my attention. The winner of the Food and Farmer Award, sponsored by the James Hutton Institute, was Kincloon Organic Nature Farm in Angus. The focus of this award is to demonstrate that it is in the power of Scottish farmers to farm their way out of the biodiversity crisis by placing environmental and biodiversity consideration at the heart of management decisions. The food system is hugely complex, so joined up food policies are essential to deliver on many different goals. Dignified access to good food for all, restoring nature on the land, in the sea, improving health, tackling climate changes, creating good jobs throughout the supply chain, and building stronger communities. The Good Food Nation Bill introduced to Parliament could lay the foundation for this joined up food policy in Scotland, although it needs to be strengthened. The cross-party support from the Right of Food Bill, as proposed by Elaine Smith, MSP, in the previous session, and brought forward again by my colleague Rhoda Grant, also shows the support for action now. As the rest of the economy decarbonizes, food system will account for an increasing proportion of both Scottish and global emissions, and we can expect food to be the higher up in the agenda at COP27. Given Scotland's leadership role in under two coalition of subnational governments, I would encourage the Scottish Government to promote the Glasgow Declaration on Food and Climate over the next 12 months of the UK presidency. In leading up to COP27 in Egypt, let us match this global action with strong, right-based Good Food Nation Bill at home. A national food plan can only be effective if local food plans are developed too. And I hope for an assurance that local authorities will be involved in developing any national food plan. For our local authorities to take the steps needed in reducing greenhouse gas emissions from urban and regional food system, there needs to be far more support provided. And I look forward to hearing from the Minister on the steps that will be taken across Scotland to turn commitments in Glasgow Food and Climate Change Declaration into a reality. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Choudhury. I now call on Emma Harper, who will be followed by Brian Whittle. Around 4 minutes, Ms. Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate linking food and climate change and congratulate Foysol Choudhury on securing it. It's clear that the Paris Agreement and the Glasgow Declaration from COP26 cannot be reached without addressing food systems. Farmers are at the front line of climate change. They experience the effects of extreme and unpredictable weather, and they can and indeed are a huge part of the solution to tackle the climate emergency and support food security. Presiding Officer, producing food and drinks sustainably means rearing, growing and processing it in a way that helps preserve and protect the environment for future generations. And during this year's Parliament's Festival of Politics, I chaired an event called Will Vegans Really Save the Planet? The event explored sustainable food production and the role our diet has in tackling the climate emergency. And the event highlighted a University of Oxford report that the food system is globally responsible for a third of all greenhouse gases. It also explored whether reducing the amount of meat and dairy consumed helps reduce agriculture's environmental impact. One of the conclusions of the event was that a vegan diet and meat substitutes can involve intensive water use, high air miles caused by flying certain products like avocados across the globe, and can significantly contribute to deforestation. One of the key messages for consumers was that procuring food sustainably means buying it from producers who minimise their impact on their environment, for example, by reducing their carbon emissions and support the longevity of the industry. This is why schemes like Scotland Loves Local, Shop Local and local farmers markets like in Moffat, Dumfries, Kirkcudbright, Wigtown and a newly established market in Stranraer are so important to support. I thank all who support these initiatives. It was also clear from the event that a vegan diet is not the sole solution to tackle the climate emergency. Supporting our agricultural businesses to be sustainable is crucial. Presiding Officer, I welcome the steps which are being taken by the Scottish Government to support our agricultural sector's transition to net zero. I'm aware that the Scottish Government is moving forward to put in place a successor to the Common Agricultural Policy that will guide farming, food production and land use for the future. So I welcome comments or an update from the Minister as to timescales for this. The Good Food Nation Bill, as mentioned by Foysol Choudhury, it proposes local and sustainable food production along with the Agricultural Sustainability Working Group led by NFU President Martin Kennedy, and also welcomes the steps in tackling the global climate emergency. Presiding Officer, I briefly want to mention local action by constituents. Chris Nicholson, who is the Scottish Tenant Farmers Association Chair, Colin Ferguson, who is the DG Chair of NFUS, and Kenny Adams and William Moses, Machers Beef and Sheep Farmers, and filmmakers Willeke Van Ryn and Julia Farrington. The group have created an informative short film to coincide with COP26. It's called Talking with Farmers, Farming and Climate Change. You can find it on YouTube. The film highlights how important it is that farmers are supported and engaged with to tackle the climate emergency. The film provides insight and some solutions for the custodians of our land. I would encourage members to watch it, and I want to commend all involved in making it. I look forward to engaging and learning from them how we promote food sustainability and how to tackle the climate and biodiversity emergencies. Finally, Presiding Officer, I was also struck by the statement that William Moses said in the film too. He says, if we look after our soil, it will look after us. And I would like to add to that, so that we in Scotland can sustainably produce and provide what is recognised across the world as world-class food produced to some of the best welfare standards, and also support an approach that helps achieve the Sustainable Development Goals. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Harper. And I call on Brian Whittle to be followed by Martin Whitfield. Again, 4 minutes, please, Mr Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I add my thanks to Foysol Choudhury for bringing this debate to the Chamber and once again give me the opportunity to discuss the importance of food production, food processing and procurement, linking nutrition, health, education and climate change. And I have to say, Deputy Presiding Officer, it feels a wee bit like Groundhog Day since I seem to be talking about this particular topic for the last 5 years. And it is disappointing, I have to say, how little progress we've actually made within that time. I've long championed the need to process and procure food locally. We charge our farmers with the production of the highest quality of food. We give them custodianship of the countryside. We charge them with paying the living wage. We make sure they have the highest level of animal welfare. Yet when it comes to public procurement, that's where we seem to fall down. We don't seem to recognise there's a cost associated with making sure that our farmers are producing that high quality food. I did a study early on in the last term around where all the food came from in our councils and our hospitals, and to discover that through the central Excel contract that the Scottish Government have, only 16% of that food came from Scotland. I'm doing that study again just now, redoing that investigation to see if anything has moved on in the last 5 years. I think what we should highlight that this is completely possible, because we all know we've talked about this before. We have East Ayrshire, who are the gold standard when it comes to this. They are procuring something along the lines of 75% of their food for schools comes from locally. They can even tell you which farm the eggs came from. The reality is we import far too much of our food. And when we're discussing biodiversity, I think, as Emma Harper said there, the development of things that are products like soya and palm oil and almond products are hugely damaging to our climate, and they're hugely damaging to the biodiversity, because swathes of land have to be cleared. I will always take an intervention from Emma Harper.
Emma Harper.
Thank you. I'm just wondering if Brian Whittle would agree that it takes about 136 litres of water to make 1 litre of almond milk.
Brian Whittle.
I love it when you preempt what I'm just about to say, Ms Harper. And that's exactly right. When you clear the land, especially the production of almond, it is so water intensive that it's one of the worst biodiversity areas that you can have. And then you have the air miles then to import that into this country. And we also, when I mentioned palm oil there, which is also a hugely contributing factor in this country to obesity. Our farmers have been innovating towards net zero. In fact, NFU Scotland have a target ahead of the Scottish Government target of 2040. They're doing some incredible work. I've seen it out in the farms as they do that journey towards that. Even things like reducing the amount of ploughing they have to do, which ploughing releases carbon into the atmosphere. They are innovating ahead of the game. 85% of the farmland in Scotland said the best crop is actually grass. And I thought to say grass-fed livestock is the original circular economy. And the sequestration of carbon into grass is much greater than it is, for example, in a woodland. So we've got to be careful when we allow a noisy minority to lump all of global farming together, all the global farming practices together, and we talk down our farmers. Because what we should be doing is taking the way our farmers produce food and exporting that knowledge to other countries, because that's how we're going to tackle climate change. When we talk about meat production globally, it doesn't give you the whole picture. I think, you know, we have a farmer in here who will hopefully back me up on this. When we look at the practices that are in the US and the South America and the Far East, they differ hugely from the way in which our farmers produce food. And that's the way we need to be. Food can be produced environmentally friendly, and we need to champion our farmers and the effects and their efforts to drive towards net zero. And when it comes to food processing, four and a half minutes already, presenting officer, I'll get there. Food processing, we send too much of it away to outside of our borders to get packaged. So let's push local food production, support our farmers, develop processing locally, and public procurement should always take Scottish food wherever possible. That positive impact on climate change and the health of our nation and the rural economy. Joined up thinking, Deputy Presiding Officer, what a breakthrough that would be. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Whittle. Time flies indeed. Martin Whitfield to be followed by Ari Amber. Just 4 minutes, please.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it's a great pleasure to speak in this Members' debate, and I extend my thanks to my friend Foysol for bringing it this evening and tackling such an important problem, and I'm going to use the word problem, that faces Scotland going forward. And it is a great pleasure to follow Brian Whittle, who made so much of what I was going to point out, so I'm merely going to echo some of the elements of what he said and hopefully carry on for the small parts that he missed out. Because when we talk about farming and we talk about food, I think one of the phrases that you used about our farmers being the custodians of this country is so fundamentally important and unfortunately so frequently forgotten. I think back to my time as a primary school teacher, when I always looked forward to going out and visiting our farmers to watch the faces of young people understand, in some cases, where potatoes and carrots came from, but more excitedly, those that discovered that actually the jobs that sit in our farms are not muddy, they're not cold and wet jobs, they're highly technical IT jobs, looking after the software that drives the tractors, the satellite navigation. And the fact that I know of two individuals who were so taken by their journey to a farm that they changed what they wanted to do going forward to STEM subjects. And one of them, I know, has in fact ended up working on a farm and thoroughly enjoys working, not with a tractor, not with a spade, but with a robotic flying device that plucks out the weeds that sit in the farms. And I raise that because that is one end of the farming, and at the other end, there are farmers who still travel out every day and labour. But I raise it because farming has changed so much in the past 20 years. And it is good to see the NFU, through their members, through other farmers, throwing themselves fully behind a net zero future. And they do that not perhaps, as sometimes people raise, from the hope, but actually from their knowledge and understanding of the countryside that they can achieve this. And so I want to congratulate our farmers and urge the government to listen, as I know they say they do, to both the NFU but also to their members, and in particular to the individual voices of unique farms that need unique support to allow them to make the changes going forward. I'd also like to offer a small tale from a few years ago which feeds into that concept of food processing, where in East Lothian there was a farm that, well, still does grow Brussels sprouts, but just before Christmas its Brussels sprouts travelled all the way to Poland to receive a cross in the bottom of them to get packaged up and then come all the way back to be sold in a well-known supermarket that literally overlooked the field that they were grown in. And the farmer was just stunned that due to regulation, due to finance, that was the only way he could make his crop make money. And that goes back to the other point that Brian raised about how we can localise both the growth of our food, the distribution of our food, but also the purchasing of our food through our schools, through our hospitals, through our local authorities, and to start to make the same circle, the virtuous circle, that our cows have achieved through 300,000 years of evolution. Just before I finish, I would like to make mention of one group that's raised in this, and that's in respect of seafood and the Scottish Creel Fishermen's Federation and their support for low impact and sustainable development of our local seas. And I would ask the Minister tonight whether or not she can comment on whether or not there should be a protective circle around our Scottish waters to stop trawling, which is damaging the creel fishermen's going forward. Thank you, Deputy President.
Thank you, Mr. Whitfield. I now call on Ariane Burgess to be followed by Stephen Kerr. 4 minutes, Ms. Burgess.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you, Foysol Choudhury, for securing this vital debate. At COP26, the Scottish Government joined the 50 by 30 coalition, recognising the necessity of cutting emissions by 50% by 2030. Agriculture and food systems will play a crucial role in this effort. I commend the Scottish Government on signing up to the 4 per 1,000 initiative, which aims to boost carbon storage in agricultural soils and reduce global carbon footprint. Presiding Officer, soil is where it all begins. Healthy agricultural soils have huge potential to store carbon. 80% of Scotland's land is used for agriculture, so we should maximise this nature-based solution through better soil management. Soils play a crucial role in storing water, which prevents flooding. This will become even more important as we feel the increased impact of climate change. Healthy soils also produce nutritious, flavoursome, and filling food. This is why, when considering food and climate change, we need to start from the ground up. We must develop a holistic policy which shapes and supports the entire system, from soil management to regenerative farming techniques, to local food supply chains, to access to good quality food, all benefiting nature, climate, and well-being. Here are some steps that Scotland should take, starting with improving soil health. By developing a national nitrogen strategy, we can end the excessive use of inorganic fertiliser, reduce air and water pollution, improve soil health, and slash greenhouse gases. We should set a bold target, 25% by 2025 for organic public procurement. This would incentivise farmers to shift to organic production and help us reach our target of at least doubling the area of land under organic management during this parliamentary session. Moving from soil to wider land use, We need to find the right balance for how land is used between food production, carbon absorption, nature restoration, renewable energy infrastructure and housing. But agriculture and nature restoration do not always have to compete. The Nature Restoration Fund should benefit farmers and crofters who contribute to nature corridors. Many farmers, crofters and growers such as Phil and Laura from the Wildlife Croft on Skye are starting to practice agroforestry, where trees and agriculture coexist. But they've found that the current crofting grant system and agricultural payments do not support this, despite the co-benefits for food production, soil health and climate biodiversity. Certainly, Finlay, I will take an intervention.
Full names, please. Finlay Carson.
Thank you. I appreciate you taking an intervention. Could you perhaps tell the Chamber how long it takes for a farmer to transition to be an organic farmer, and how would the loss in production be compensated for in that time it took to change to be organic?
And through the chair, Finlay Carson, Ariane Burgess.
Thank you for that, Mr. Carson. As we have heard in the Rain Committee, it takes considerable amount of time to transition, and that is why we're only calling on at least doubling the current 1.8% of organic land that is currently under organic production. So we need to go. We want to go far, and what I'm calling for is an incentivising to point farmers in a direction, based on conversations I have been having with people from the NFUS. Continuing on, we must change the incentives to support our food producers to adopt climate and nature-friendly practices, and we must start offering this support as soon as possible. The Agricultural Bill is a once-in-a-multi-generational opportunity to reshape food production. The government has said 50% of the new support payments will be conditional on providing environmental benefits. This is encouraging, but the percentage that is conditional can be increased. But before that, we need greater investment in a just transition for agriculture to support those who produce the food that sustains us. I encourage the government to establish an advisory service to provide training and advice support pilot programs and knowledge transfer, and scale up good practice. And finally, the Good Food Nation Bill should spell out the vision for a good food nation and include outcomes that the plans should help deliver, including food systems that promote ecological regeneration and align with climate targets, and empowerment through food education and community food production. In this parliamentary session, we can transform our food system. Let's place soil, land use and nutritious food at the heart of the response to our climate emergency. Thank you,
Ms. Burgess. And I call on Stephen Kerr to be followed by Stephanie Callaghan. 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and congratulations to Foysol Choudhury on bringing this debate to the Chamber. We have a great deal to be proud of in the way food production has evolved in Scotland, and we have a strong future to look forward to. The world wants our products, and I know that from personal experience. And Deputy Presiding Officer, we have always been innovative in this regard in Scotland. And as the world moves away from high-yield, low-quality meats towards more environmentally friendly options, the long history of sustainability in the Scottish beef herd will put our products at the heart of a high-quality, low-yield, carbon-neutral farming future. We have a great history, too, in aquaculture in Scotland. Farmed fish consumption globally makes up half of the global fish consumption, and this is projected to grow. And we have the expertise and we have an excellent product to sell the world. And despite the fear-mongering, this sector still represents a huge part of Scotland's food exports. So what is the Minister doing to encourage and support the aquaculture sector? The same variety of issues come up when we look at the Scottish Government's attitude to the use of gene editing technology in crops. A gene responsible for drought resistance in barley crops was recently found. It is a defence against the effects of climate change. Last year, the European cereal crop was badly affected by the lack of water, and gene editing technology offers a solution. And yet we still remain close-minded to gene-edited crops. It's a wholly mistaken attitude. So when will the Minister review this retrograde an anti-science policy? Well, I already know the answer to that question, because before I stood up, just minutes before I stood up, I had a written response from the Minister to a question similar to this I'd already posed, and she says, basically, when our masters in Brussels tell us we can do it. It's pretty disappointing. And this is a series of disappointments I've had in parliamentary questions as it's emerged that the Scottish Government was not supporting any aquaponics projects. Now, this is a type of food production which mixes fish farming and the growing of crops. It is efficient, recycling nutrients within a closed system. Similarly, the Scottish Government have not looked at any recent projects in respect of vertical farming, which is an essential way of growing food that reduces the need for low-paid seasonal workers in the food production sector and reduces land use. This is essential as we move toward rewilding and more forestry in Scotland. I know that these issues are subject to an ongoing review, but what in Scotland today is not subject to ongoing reviews? Sometimes in government, you have to make decisions. Would the Minister update us on the progress of this review and tell us what actions they plan to take forward to support innovation? In a country where the average age of farmers is now 59 years old, we know there's a huge challenge ahead of us in producing enough food to feed a growing global population. Well, and we know that this challenge is made more difficult from the need to reduce carbon emissions. We know that land use will change fundamentally as a result of climate change. Therefore, innovation is key in this area, as in so many other areas, in response to the call for us to become net zero in terms of carbon emissions. Farms need to diversify. But too often in Scotland, this has meant opening up a glamping pod or getting a grant to rewild the land. And all of this is worthy. But how are we to feed ourselves when farms are turned over to custodianship? The Scottish Government must stand alongside Scotland's farmers, be open to innovation. I will. I was on my last three words, but if it's all right with you, Deputy
Minister, I can give you the time back, Jim Fairley, briefly.
I'm happy to have Jim Fairley intervene.
Thank you for taking the intervention, Mr. Kerr. I'm confused, because you're talking about when are the Scottish Government going to give production. If I understand you correctly, when are the Scottish Government going to give production their priority? But the UK Government have already said that their entire support system will be based around access to land and environmental transferring to environmental, whereas the Scottish Government have already said that food production will be 50% of the policy that they're bringing forward. We're committed to producing food in this country. The UK Government are committed to going into an environmental side of things, which we have been doing for generations. So I just don't understand your logic and where you went with that point.
Stephen Kerr.
Well, I'm very happy to take the intervention. But, you know, that would come a lot better from a member of the SNP if they actually came up with some proposals about the future of farm payments. At least the UK government have produced something that has been debated and discussed and is ongoing in that process. But in this parliament, we've heard nothing. Would the member like to intervene?
Rachel Hamilton.
Would Stephen Kerr agree with me that farmers cannot meet these climate change objectives with an SNP government that cuts agri-environmental climate change funding?
Well, Stephen Kerr.
I think there's a world of difference between what the rhetoric of this SNP Scottish government is about and what they actually do and what they actually deliver in terms of outcomes. And that is why I call upon the minister to respond to my invitation to her and her colleagues to stand up and stand alongside Scotland's farmers, to be open to innovation and to embrace science. How about being pro-science and pro-free trade?
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. I now call on Stephanie Callaghan to be followed by Paul Sweeney. 4 minutes, Ms. Callaghan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to Foysol for bringing this important debate to the Chamber. The global food system is not only a victim of climate change, it's also one of the world's main polluters. The World Wildlife Fund tell us food production is one of the biggest threats to our planet. They do have a point. Food systems are responsible for 60% of global nature loss and over one-third of total greenhouse gas emissions. COP26 rightly focused on important topics such as deforestation and emissions, but I was disappointed the impact of food systems and climate change was less prominent. Fortunately, food was on the menu during many of the roundtable discussions, and while food does present a threat to climate change, there are global opportunities too. As Susan Aitken, leader of Glasgow City Council, noted, food is the point where climate change and health come together. And it's this connection between food systems, climate change and inequality. That's why I always champion Scotland becoming a good food nation. For me, the Glasgow Food and Climate Declaration, I think it was getting a bit heated, so I won't at the moment. For me, the Glasgow Food and Climate Declaration was a significant output from COP26, placing food and local action at the heart of our climate emergency response. Almost 90 sub-national governments have signed up to this declaration that seeks to tackle the climate emergency through developing integrated food policies. Scotland's one of the declaration signatories, and I'm delighted South Lanarkshire Council is one of seven Scottish local authorities to sign up. That's great news for Uddingston and Bells Hill residents across my constituency. Beyond the Glasgow Declaration, our Scottish Government has in train a series of interventions that provide opportunities to transform our food systems and respond to the environmental challenge. Central to the Scottish Government's response is the overarching Good Food Nation Scotland Bill, which will see national and local governments creating Good Food Nation plans that deliver local responses underpinned by national policy imperatives. While supporting the environment is key, there are broader benefits to health, social and economic well-being too. Presiding Officer, I share the anxiety of many climate activists that COP26 has been big in promises but less clear in delivery. It's vital that nations transparently report and progress as food systems are redesigned, and I welcome the Scottish Government's intention to publish progress reports against our Good Food Nation plan every 2 years. COP26 activists rightly highlighted that transparency is critical to accelerating responses to combat climate change. Scotland can co-produce solutions that provide us all with affordable access to local produce. By continuing to work collaboratively with our world-class farming sector, Scottish farming is rightly renowned for its sustainable approach. With Scotland's strong foundations, we can reimagine our food system. Harvesting more local, organic and plant-based produce is achievable. I trust we can harness our collective will and reputation for innovation to make that happen. School students from right across Lanarkshire have already lobbied me about the lack of sustainable vegetarian and vegan options in school canteens. I hear them and I agree with them. We must work harder to increase balanced plant-based food options and work harder to offer more local produce. As discussed at COP26, the Scottish Government is also delivering policies and interventions that place food at the heart of our responses to tackle inequalities. Extending free school meals and Best Start food grants confirm Scotland's focus on improving people's wellbeing while reducing harmful emissions and nature loss. Our Scottish councils are already spending around £65 million per year in food supplies. Presiding Officer, COP26 can either be a turning point for how our global food system works, or it can turn out to be nothing more than a two-week jamboree for world leaders and celebrities. We owe it to our grandchildren and their children that it is the former, and I look forward to Scotland leading the global response as a good food nation.
Thank you, Ms Callaghan. I now call on the final speaker in the open debate, Paul Sweeney. 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it's a real pleasure to join this debate, and I congratulate my friend Foysol Choudhury from Lothian Region for securing it and a very apt moment to discuss this issue. I'm very proud that Glasgow as a city gives its name to this declaration, so vital as it is for the survival of mankind, and actually what an opportunity too for our collective economic potential as well. I think that's something that's often overlooked, that it's not about a sacrifice, it's actually about realising entrepreneurial spirit and realising a potential opportunity for our cities and regions across the world. The colleagues so far have already rehearsed much of the issues around the waste that is so apparent in our society when we actually realise the sheer scale of it. It's staggering. 36 million tonnes of greenhouse gases from food alone, 1.3 billion tonnes a year globally, if you look at just from the UK share of that. But also the cost of that in terms of financial and economic costs. In the UK, businesses, homes and food manufacturers throwing away 9.5 million tonnes of food worth £19 billion a year. What an amazing opportunity to address that and at the same time contain our emissions. Happy to give way.
Brian Whittle.
I'm really grateful for the member to take her intervention at this point, because I've been trying to get in this for ages. I wonder if he'd agree with me that the fact that a third of the world's food is going to waste and accounts for something between 8 and 10% of global emissions. And if food waste were a country, it would be the third highest carbon emitter after the USA and China. Does he agree with me that it seems ridiculous that in a time when we have such food poverty, that we're not joining up these dots and reducing that kind of wastage?
Paul Sweeney.
Absolutely, and a really striking analogy that or mechanism of describing that, to think that it's if it were a country, the third highest emitter in the world. And I think that is true. We have no global institutional capacity to recognise where surpluses and deficits are occurring and how we address that. And I think that is something that the international community must take much more into cognizance as we look forward. And it's very hard to sometimes reconcile the macro level, the global level of this discussion and the effects with how we can meaningfully adjust matters more locally. And I think that's why it was quite important that this was announced in Glasgow, because there are practical steps being taken in the city to address this issue. And I think it's worth exploring those opportunities in more detail. As often was said, you know, we have to think globally but act locally. And I think this is a very good example. I joined Glasgow businesses during COP26 who are launching the Plate Up for Glasgow campaign. And it's been piloted by the Glasgow Chambers of Commerce through its Circular Glasgow initiative and funded by Experience Glasgow Food and Drink and the Drink Regional Group. And it was hosted and has been led by Giovanna Eusebi of Eusebi's Deli, one of Glasgow's great restaurants. And one of the amazing things that Eusebi's have been doing is promoting the idea that, you know, the tradition of Southern Italy was that you would never throw things away, that it would be actually seen as sacrilege to throw food away, that the poverty of some of those communities meant that the scarcity of food was treated as precious. And I think the abundance of food in our rich society has often led to having a very wasteful attitude. So trying to take that culture into our current behaviours is so important. The idea that you would adjust portion sizes, that recognising that Glasgow businesses, if you're running a restaurant in Glasgow, you're likely to throw away £10,000 worth of food a year. Trying to adjust that sort of issue, trying to reuse as much of the ingredients as possible to minimise waste. It was really a great insight into how businesses can adjust and reduce their costs and improve their efficiency and competitiveness, as well as reducing waste in the community. But furthermore, the idea of a circular economy. Glasgow's parks have seen a budget cut of 70% in the last 10 years. There's 5,115 acres of parkland in Glasgow. If we can start to cultivate that land, more of it, certainly not all of it, but certainly a significantly larger share of it, we could actually be growing more of that food locally, earning money commercially in the city by selling the produce to local restaurants, and that can help to actually create a sustainable model for the management of Glasgow's parks. So just another example of how, rather than having a dependency model where we're having to cut things and retrench, we can actually have a more entrepreneurial approach where we manage public assets like parklands to actually realise income from them and actually create a more sustainable circular economy in the city. So I really want to commend Play Up for Glasgow for what they're trying to achieve in Glasgow. And I would urge you to have a look at their website, playupforglasgow.co.uk. Just really great to see how we can take that global impact and adjust it to local policies that can really potentially make a big difference. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Sweeney. I now call on Mary McCallum to respond to the debate. Minister, for around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. It's been great to hear the debate this afternoon. I should like to begin by thanking, as the others have, Foysol Choudhury for lodging this really important motion, and thank all the members who have taken part. There's been lots of good ideas shared, such as the nature of this discussion when it pertains to climate change and environment. We touch on so many aspects of the economy and society, and so it should be. There was some consensus, which I think is very good, a lot of posturing and faux outrage from the Tory benches, which is deeply ironic given that it was their chums in Westminster who, in post-Brexit trade deals, have undercut, have undermined and crucially have ignored the calls from Scottish farmers, indeed the pleas from Scottish farmers to be listened to, and they ought to be ashamed of themselves for that. I'll make progress now, but if you want to come in later on, I'd be glad to take an intervention. Presiding Officer, it is hard to overstate how important food systems are to us all. Food sustains us through the nutrition and energy it provides, but also connects us with our culture, our history, our land. It plays a crucial role in our economy and has, as has been set out a number of times this afternoon, will be a key theme in our journey to net zero. Having COP26 in Scotland was an immense opportunity for Scotland. We are not yet a state negotiator, but as a subnational host government, it provided us with a unique opportunity to showcase our world-leading action, but perhaps more importantly, to learn from others around the world about the action that they are taking, including on food systems. The Glasgow Declaration on Food and Climate, it unites signatories around a pledge to accelerate the development of integrated food policies, and crucially, it calls on national authorities, who are so often holding the tools and the funding that is required here, to take action to ensure that food policy is aligned with credible and tangible change. The Scottish Government has long valued the role of food in our national well-being, our economy and in the very fabric of our society, and that's why we were so proud that Scotland was the first national government to sign the Glasgow Declaration pledge and demonstrating our wholehearted commitment to this joined-up approach. And just while we're here, I should like to take the opportunity to thank Nourish Scotland, who've been one of the, if not the key partner in drafting the Glasgow Declaration. And I think the fact that now so many have signed up to the Declaration is really testament to their hard work. Presiding Officer, we are very proud that this project began in Scotland. And I really do welcome the consensus across the Chamber and the support for this project that the Scottish Government was so pleased to get behind. The recognition of that is welcome. And again, I thank Foysol Choudhury for the opportunity to discuss it. Of course, though, it is not just for governments to take action. The public sector could never take this challenge on alone. And business has a really important part to play. During COP26, on the 9th of November, the Scotland Food and Drink Partnership launched their Net Zero Commitment, a plan to unite industry consisting of 5 long-term commitments underpinned by a programme of practical interventions. Would the
Minister take a mention?
Glad to.
Finlay Carson.
Thank you. I appreciate you taking my intervention. Presiding Officer, gene editing techniques allow the breeding of new crops more quickly, which is essential right now to mitigate the challenges posed by climate changes. And the James Hutton Institute, which is often quoted here and part of the work that the government have done, has welcomed plans unveiled by DEFRA to pave the way to enable gene editing technologies in England. Gene editing can unlock benefits for nature, the environment, and help farmers develop crops with enhanced resistance to pest disease and the extreme weather conditions that we're likely to see in the future. So why does the Minister oppose this without basing our decisions on scientific evidence, but more with the obsession with keeping pace with the EU? And will you tell us why you won't consider the government's position, which will ultimately damage Scotland's ability to innovate and use facilities like the Hutton Institute, which are world-leading, and should be at the forefront of tackling the implications of climate change?
I won't tell you anything, Mr Carson, but I will ask the Minister to respond to your intervention.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Happy to respond. And firstly, to assure the Member that we do not take decisions in absence of scientific advice, and we take it all the time. And I'm very clear about the progress as regards gene editing and the judicial reasoning coming out of the EU as regards the separation with gene modification. It's a very important subject. I'm following it closely, but the Scottish Government's position on gene modification has not changed at this stage. The leading body on environmental protection. I think we would do well to follow the EU in that regard. Presiding Officer, today's motion rightly asserts that our journey to net zero must go through the farm gate. Scottish farmers and producers are central to driving this agenda. Our Agriculture Reform Implementation Oversight Board, which is co-chaired by Martin Kennedy and the Cabinet Secretary Marie Goujon, are working really hard to find out and to plan how we can support farming and food production in Scotland to become a global leader in sustainable and regenerative agriculture. And I would point members who've asked about... Happy to.
Brian Whittle.
I'm very grateful for the Minister to take the information. Can she explain to us really why... And one of the things that really drives me is the fact that Scotland is the unhealthiest nation in Europe, yet we produce some of the highest quality food in the world, and somehow those two things are not being joined together through the public procurement process. And that's been the case for the last 5 years. Would you tell us what plans the government have to try and join up those dots?
Minister.
Thank you, and thank the member for the intervention, and I'm happy to explain. Just on the point of procurement, I'm sure you're already aware of the figures, but for the sake of others in the chamber, Scottish products are estimated to account for around 48% of public sector spend, which is up from 34% in 2007. So it is increasing, albeit that work has to be done. And I hope that the Good Food Nation Bill, which will acknowledge that Scotland has this incredible natural larder, will tackle that problem that too many people are not able to access the nutritious value that is here, which is being produced in Scotland. Presiding officer, I was talking about supporting farmers and crofters to produce more of our own food needs sustainably and to farm and croft with nature. Make no mistake that finding solutions to the problem posed by climate change will require action at all levels, and we aim to learn from different communities, organisations and individuals that are already building local food systems with innovative approaches. And I am conscious of the time, having taken so many interventions.
I can give you the time back, Minister.
Thank you very much. In that regard, in the vein of learning from others, we remain committed to increasing the sourcing of local produce in the public sector, and our support for the Soil Association's Food for Life programme, which I'm sure the member is aware of, continues. And it's now operating in school settings across 17 local authorities, which is more than half, and has already made a big difference to the lives of many young people across this country. The programme contributes to our goals of becoming a good food nation, reducing inequality and achieving net zero emissions by 2045. And we are in active discussions with the Soil Association on options to extend that programme into other public sector settings, which I know was mentioned in an earlier speech. I really must make progress, but hopefully next time. I mentioned there, Presiding Officer, reducing inequality. This government is committed in everything that we do to driving social justice and ensuring that no one is left behind. In climate action, this means putting people at the heart of our efforts and enshrining the principles of just transition in law, which this Parliament did. I really must make progress. It's the same as it was 5 seconds ago. And that very much applies to food policy. This ethos underpins much of the action we're already taking by becoming a good food nation by 2025. And as has been mentioned, we introduced the Good Food Nation Bill to this Parliament recently. The bill will enshrine our ambition to be a good food nation, where people from every walk of life take pride and pleasure in and benefit from the food that they produce, buy, cook, serve and eat every day. It will underpin a whole lot of work that the Scottish Government is already undertaking. And as I said to the member after his intervention, it's the foundation upon which we will build a country where everyone can access Scotland's delicious and nutritious natural larder of meat, fish, dairy, oats, kale and much more. It will provide the overarching framework for clear, consistent and coherent future food policy that is in line with the aims of the Glasgow Declaration. And I'll take this opportunity in closing, Presiding Officer, simply to encourage other governments to follow where Scotland has led in embedding sustainable, fair and integrated food policy. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate and I close this meeting of Parliament.